and experiencing these past 2 weeks, also, of course, through the lens of music, since music also matters. So we're going to kind of put these two concepts together today and hopefully find some hope. Yeah. So the music we're going to share today, all of it, every piece, is our musical responses to justice and the cry for justice, cries against racism, brutality.
Okay.
All songs coming out of the African American experience in this country, in this, well, the last two centuries now. And we know from our own tradition that when people suffer, they cry out. Our own liturgical tradition is filled with these moments, especially in the Psalms, on the High Holidays. Before we start the shofar service, we have this psalm, Mina Meitzar Karatia, out of the depths, I cried unto the Lord. Right? Mima Amakim Karaticha Adonai, from the depths of sorrow, we cry out to God. And we're going to focus on that experience in our own country. We're going to begin with a song. I'm going to ask, actually, everyone should mute themselves. Or Don, if you can do that. And then when we'll have discussion, we'll ask you to unmute yourselves. So Don, I don't know if, I guess as the host, you can mute everyone, yes? Let's see. All right.
Yes, I can.
Thank you. All right, so we're going to go back to early in the 20th century. And after this this commentary, which I think you're going to find fascinating in a number of ways, we'll listen to this extraordinary and very powerful, bizarre song in a certain way called Strange Fruit, as recorded by the legendary Billie Holiday. So here's the story behind the song. One of Billie Holiday's most iconic songs, it's titled Strange Fruit. Strange Fruit, a rather curious title for a song, and is a haunting protest against the inhumanity of racism. There it is, a haunting protest against the inhumanity of racism. Many people know that the man who wrote the song was inspired by a photograph of a lynching. But you might not realize that he's also tied to another watershed moment in America's history. The man behind Strange Fruit was New York City's Abel Meeropol, M-E-E-R-O-P-O-L. And he really has two stories. And they both begin at DeWitt Clinton High School, which was a public high school in the Bronx that has an outstanding number of famous people in its alumni, the great writer, thinker, James Baldwin, County Cullen, Richard Rogers, Burt Lancaster, Stan Lee, Neil Simon, Richard Avedon, Ralph Lauren, and the list goes on and on. Meeropol graduated from DeWitt Clinton in 1921. He went on to teach English there at that school for 17 years. He was also a poet and a social activist. In the late 1930s, Meeropol was very disturbed at the continuation of racism in America and seeing a photograph of a lynching put him over the edge. Mirapol once said that the photograph haunted him for days. So he wrote a poem about it, which was then printed in a teachers' union publication. He was also an amateur composer, and he set words to music. He played it for a New York club owner who ultimately gave it to Billie Holiday. When Holiday decided to sing Strange Fruit, the song reached millions of people. While the lyrics never mention lynching directly or explicitly, the metaphor is painfully clear. Here are the words. Southern trees bear a strange fruit, blood on the leaves and blood at the root. Black body swinging in the southern breeze. Strange fruit hanging from poplar trees. Pastoral scene of the gallant South. The bulging eyes and the twisted mouth. Scent of magnolia sweet and fresh. And the sudden smell of burning flesh. Here is a fruit for the crows to pluck, for the rain to gather, for the wind to suck, for the sun to rot, for a tree to drop. Here is a strange and bitter crop. In 1999, Time magazine named Strange Fruit the song of the century. The Library of Congress put it in the National Recording Registry. It's been recorded dozens of times. Herbie Hancock and Marcus Miller did an instrumental version, with Miller evoking the poem on his mournful bass clarinet. Miller went on to say he was surprised to learn that the song was written by a white Jewish guy from the Bronx. Strange Fruit, he says, took extraordinary courage, both for Mirapol to write and for Holiday to sing. The 60s hadn't happened yet, he says. Things like that weren't talked about. They certainly weren't sung about. And New York lawmakers didn't like Strange Fruit either. In 1940, Mirapol was called to testify before a committee investigating communism in public schools. They wanted to know whether the American Communist Party had paid him to write the song. They had not, but like many New York teachers in his day, Mirapol was a communist. Journalist David Margalek, who wrote Strange Fruit, the biography of a song, says, "There are a million reasons to disparage communism now. But American communism, one point it had in its favor, that it was concerned about civil rights very early." Mirapol left his teaching job at DeWitt Clinton in 1945. He eventually quit the Communist Party. But that's where the second part of Mirapol's story begins. Abel Mirapol's pen name was Lewis Allen. Lewis Allen were the names of their children who were still born, who never lived. He and his older brother, Michael, were raised, this was quoted by Robert Mirapol. He and his older brother, Michael, were raised by Abel Mirapol and his wife, Ann Mirapol, after the boys' parents, hold on to your seats, Ethel and Julius Rosenberg, were executed for espionage in 1953. So Abe Mirapol and his wife adopted the children of Ethel and Julius Rosenberg after they were executed. Their trial, the Rosenbergs' trial and execution, made national headlines. There was also something of a salacious element, given that the Rosenbergs were a married couple. New accounts described it as the first husband and wife to die in the electric chair. At the time, the Rosenberg sons, Robert and Michael, were 6 and 10 years old, respectively. News photographs of the boys showed them dressed in suits, visiting their parents in prison. And there, these little boys, they're wearing these caps, and they look so young and so vulnerable. It's really a very poignant image. And Mirapol's son Robert says that in the months following his parents' execution, it was unclear who would take care of him and his brother. It was the height of McCarthyism. Even family members were fearful of being in any way associated with the Rosenbergs or communism. And then at a Christmas party at the home of the writer W.E.B. Du Bois, the boys were introduced to Abel and Ann Mirapol. A few weeks later, they were living with them. One of the most remarkable things was how quickly we adapted, Robert says. First of all, Abel, what I remember about him as a six-year-old was that he was a real jokester. He liked to tell silly jokes and play word games, and he would put on these comedy shows that would leave me rolling. There is something else about Abel Mirapol that seems to connect the man who wrote Strange Fruit to the man who created a loving family out of a national scandal. He was incredibly soft-hearted. For example, there was an old Japanese maple tree in their backyard which sent out many new seedlings every year. I was the official lawnmower, Robert says, and I was going to mow over them. And he yelled to me, "Oh no, you can't kill the seedlings. What are you going to do with them, Dad? There are dozens of them." Well, he dug them up, put them in coffee cans, and lined them up alongside of the house. And there were hundreds of them, but he couldn't bring himself to just kill them. It was just something he couldn't do. After Mirapol died in 1986, his sons, Robert and Michael, both became college professors. They're also both involved in social issues. Robert founded the Rosenberg Fund for Children. And he says that even after all these years, he still finds himself unable to kill things in his own garden. So in a moment, we'll listen to Billie Holiday's recording of this song of the century. One last thing about Mirapol. He was quoted as saying, "I am a Jew. How can I tell? The Negro lynching reminds me well that I am a Jew." Here is Billie Holiday singing Strange Fruit.
Sweet and fresh. in the sudden smell of burning flesh. Here is a fruit for the crows to pluck, for the rain to gather, for the wind to suck, for the sun to rot, for the tree to drop.
Well, I can take a moment of silence after that. In a moment, we're going to hear two versions of the spiritual "We Shall Overcome." The first, before I continue with that, I just want to let you know that that quote of his about "I am a Jew," is from a poem that Mirapol wrote. He didn't just say it, but it was one of the lines in a poem he wrote. So back to "We Shall Overcome." The first is by the legendary singer Mahalia Jackson, singing "We Shall Overcome." And the second version after that is by a more contemporary version by an all-male choir from Morehouse College, singing a more contemporary version of "We Shall Overcome." So first up, Mahalia Jackson, and just take it in.
"I freely eat of every tree in the garden, but you must not eat from the tree of the knowledge of
God." Yeah, Lord, Lord, Lord. One sweet day, we shall overcome.
No, to eat, discover the truth, the pain, racism, and difference. We shall overcome. This was strange.
Don, let me interrupt for a second. We're hearing two things at the same time.
Yes. I realize that. Stand by.
Mm-hmm. Might have been an interesting combination, actually, but we're going to hear them separately. Here we go.
"Lord, one day, we shall all have peace one day. We shall all have peace one day. We shall all have peace. Love. love. We should all be free one day, love. We shall all be free, Lord, one day. Lord, Lord, if it ever hard, yeah, I do believe, Lord, we shall.
I'll give you a few seconds on, so in a moment we'll hear the All Men's Black Choir from Morehouse College. Morehouse College, it's a private, historically black men's college in Atlanta, Georgia. And we'll hear their extraordinary men's chorus singing We Shall Overcome.
Oh.
Well, as you might have gathered, that was not the all-male choir from Morehouse College. That was the Glory Gospel Singers. Stirring nonetheless. We're going to move on now to another really powerful, powerful piece of music and writing that was based on a poem and a song by Gil Scott Heron. He first recorded this in 1970, in an album that was titled Small Talk at 125th and Lenox. For anyone who's lived in New York, you know what that is. And in that original recording, he recited the lyrics and was accompanied by congas and bongo drums. Remember, this was 1970. Then he re-recorded it with a full band in 1971. The piece is titled, The Revolution Will Not Be Televised. The song's title was originally a popular slogan among the 1960s Black Power movements in the United States. Its lyrics either mention or allude to several television series, advertising slogans, and icons of entertainment and news coverage that serve as examples of what the revolution will not be or do. And the song is a response to the spoken word piece, When the Revolution Comes, by the Last Poets. And he starts the piece with this line, When the revolution comes, some of us will probably catch it on television. It was inducted into the National Recording Registry in 2005. Here is Gil Scott Heron, The Revolution Will Not Be Televised, from 1971. Listen carefully to the lyrics.
You will not be able to stay home, brother. You will not be able to plug in, turn on, and cop out. You will not be able to lose yourself on Skag and skip out for beer during commercials because the revolution will not be televised. The revolution will not be televised. The revolution will not be brought to you by Xerox in four parts without commercial interruptions. The revolution will not show you pictures of Nixon blowing a bugle and leading a charge by John Mitchell, General Abrams, and Spiro Agnew to eat hog maws confiscated from a Harlem sanctuary. The revolution will not be televised. The revolution will not be brought to you by the Schaefer Award Theater and will not star Natalie Woods and Steve McQueen or Bullwinkle and Julia. The revolution will not give your mouth sex appeal. The revolution will not get rid of the nub. The revolution will not make you look 5 pounds thinner because the revolution will not be televised, brother. There will be no pictures of you and Willie Mae pushing that shopping cart down the block on the dead run or trying to slide that color TV into a stolen ambulance. NBC will not be able to predict the winner at 8:32 on report from 29 districts. The revolution will not be televised. There will be no pictures of pigs shooting down brothers on the instant replay. There will be no pictures of pigs shooting down brothers on the instant replay. There will be no pictures of Whitney Young being run out of Harlem on a rail with a brand new process. There will be no slow motion or still life of Roy Wilkins strolling through Watts in a red, black, and green liberation jumpsuit that he has been saving for just the proper occasion. Green Acres, Beverly Hillbillies, and Hooterville Junction will no longer be so damn relevant, and women will not care if Dick finally got down with Jane on Search for Tomorrow, because black people will be in the street looking for a brighter day. The revolution will not be televised. There will be no highlights on the 11 o'clock news and no pictures of Harry R. Woman Liberationist and Jackie Onassis blowing her nose. The theme song will not be written by Jim Webb or Francis Scott Key, nor sung by Glenn Campbell, Tom Jones, Johnny Cash, Engelbert Humperdinck, or The Rare Earth. The revolution will not be televised. The revolution will not be right back after a message about a white tornado, white lightning, or white people. You will not have to worry about a dove in your bedroom, the tiger in your tank, or the giant in your toilet bowl. The revolution will not go better with Coke. The revolution will not fight germs that may cause bad breath. The revolution will put you in the driver's seat. The revolution will not be televised, will not be televised, will not be televised, will not be televised. The revolution will be no rerun, brothers. The revolution will be live.
Funny in certain ways, bitingly funny. And it ties into the next piece we're going to hear because it's not hard to understand how the more things need to change, the more they stay the same. And in a moment, we're going to hear this beautiful, haunting recording by the great, late great Sam Cooke, who wrote this song and recorded it in 1964, just in the outbreak of the civil rights movement protests, titled, A Change is Gonna Come. A Change is Gonna Come. And there was an article in a New Yorker about 5 years ago, which is talking about the 50th anniversary of the song, and how if Sam Cooke were alive at that time, he would have changed it, you know, the more things stay the same. It's a beautiful, powerful song, almost poignant and gentle, if as well yearning and biting. So here is A Change is Gonna Come by the exquisite, exquisite singer and artist Sam Cooke.
Now I'm able to carry on. It's been a long time coming, but I know a change gon' come. Oh, yes it will.
Don, can I see myself on my screen? I seem to have lost myself. I'm not sure why that is, but in any case.
Not sure.
Okay. Sam Cooke, A Change Is Gonna Come. I'm gonna ask, everyone can unmute yourselves for now. Let's unmute them all, Don. We'll have a little discussion and response to some of these songs. And then before we go today, we're going to hear, for me, the most, at least in my life, because it was when I was a teenager, the great, late, great Marvin Gaye singing his anti-racial hatred song and protests song, What's Going On. And then we'll say goodbye with the... a video of, well, I'll explain it when we get there. But for now, anyone who has a question or comment or response, let's engage in a little dialogue now.
Anyway. Hi, Don, Randy Grant.
Hi, Randy.
Marvin Gaye was my next door neighbor. 1972 to about 78. Amazing man. Best friends with Diana Ross. Amazing man. Not a good personal life, but a true, true artist.
Yeah. Oh, one of the great, great, great artists.
One of the best.
Oh. And Randy, while you're on, you know, we're a close community. We want to share our condolences to Randy, who's his mom just passed away about a week and a half ago and lived a long and amazing, beautiful life. She was an amazing human being. And
absolutely.
So we send our condolences to you, Randy, but also we know that you're in the place now where you can celebrate, right? Celebrate her beautiful life and how much she gave to you and your whole family.
Absolutely. Thank you so much.
You're welcome, Randy.
Thanks for getting me through it, Don.
Oh, you're welcome.
Could not have done it without you. I have no other family. So Wilshire Boulevard Temple is my family. I thank you. I'm now left behind and will go on with my life and study with you on Mondays at 12 noon.
Beautiful.
So thank you.
Thank you, Randy.
You're welcome. You're very welcome.
All right. Anyone else care to offer a comment, a feeling, a thought? It can not only about the music, but what we've all been grasping our way to get through. Yeah.
Stanley always says that without the music of the revolution is not going to go anywhere. And we were marching in Israel for the housing situation. Remember when they had all the tents and everything? And
that's right.
And he kept saying, we're walking, but we're not singing.
Yes.
And the same thing is true about the protests that are going on now. Where is today's music?
I have to tell you, it's out there. It's definitely out there and it's coming and more is coming. I think it would certainly be different if people were singing while they're marching. I grant
exactly.
you that.
Exactly.
I would grant you that, right? That would be something, huh?
Yep.
And this does get back to, you know,
we sang in the 60s.
Oh, absolutely. You know, just for a moment, we began Music Matters. We talked about the power of music, how it is woven to the human experience, to human DNA. And I agree with you, with the song, it becomes something different, right? There's a sense of hope.
Yeah.
You can't be hopeless if you're singing. Right. So I agree with you. Yeah. Lori.
I have two questions. One is, when was We Shall Overcome actually written?
You know, it's a good question. I have to do a little more research because they're not exactly sure, right? But the scholars believe sometime between, you know, in the early part of the 20th century, it became well known. Mm-hmm. My guess is it a seed of it started, who knows, maybe even during the Civil War.
Yeah.
And then evolved over time as it spread to different communities around the country, which of course happened, you know, post-Civil War when African Americans, you know,
started the Great Migration.
Really, yeah. Won their freedom and could move, right?
Yeah. And I have another question, and that is, when Billie Holiday recorded Strange Fruit, wasn't there a backlash for her?
Absolutely.
Okay.
Absolutely. You know, you can imagine what life was like for an African American star, which he was then, right?
Yeah.
Singing in, yeah. You know, white nightclubs, and that's why the great jazz artist Marcus Williams said, you know, the courage of this white Jew writing those words and setting it to music, you know, he applauded Mirapol as much as Billie Holiday. You know, mm-hmm. They both put their lives on the line for that song.
Right.
So remarkable courage. Yeah.
Thank you.
Who else would like to make a comment? We have to move. Roya Milder, I see you in the gallery there.
Hello.
Hi, Roya. Sorry to call on you, but if I see a name, I'm likely to call on you.
Okay. I was really on just to listen to the music.
Right. I understand. It's okay. I'm glad you're here. How's the family? How are the kids?
Everybody's doing good. Thank you.
Yeah. It's amazing our capacity to be flexible and to make the best of things.
Yes.
Right. That is our capacity for hope, no matter what's going on around us. Right. And the music, I can't think of a better example than the making of music. So.
I was going to music helps us get through the day.
It certainly does. It certainly does. Yeah. I'll go in my house. I'm not sure it helps my daughter get through the day when she sees her father walking around the house mumbling songs out loud. She wonders about me. But, you know, I think I'll find a way to get through that too. So. Anyone else with a response, comment? All right, so here's what I want to do. I'll give you a little background on the song, Marvin Gaye's recording of What's Going On, which he wrote and recorded. It's a very powerful, really political song. The lyrics of the song were inspired by violence and police brutality in America, and that's the truth about his song and why he wrote it. And one of the songwriters. All right, we're going to ask Don. Can we mute everyone? Don. Hear me now, everyone?
Yes.
Okay. But now you guys.
What's going on here?
All right. I'm back, yes? Okay.
Yes.
So, Don, can we mute the gallery, please? Can you hear me? Here we go. So one of the song's writers, singer-songwriter Ronaldo O.B. Benson, he was one of the Four Tops. We all remember the Four Tops from the 60s and 70s. Great, great, great group. He was inspired to come up with this song when he witnessed violence and police brutality while living in Berkeley, California. And on May 15th, 1969, Benson had just arrived with the tour bus of the Four Tops in Berkeley. And he saw a group of anti-war activists protesting against the Vietnam War. Right? This is 1969. And Benson was shocked to his core to witness the sheer amount of violence and police brutality marring the protest, which was later known as Bloody Thursday. And absolutely saddened by the shocking things he was witnessing at that protest, he asked himself a number of questions, one of which was, what's happening here? And later during a meeting Benson had with his songwriter friend Al Cleveland, he brought up the topic of Bloody Thursday. Cleveland later went on to compose a song based on the concerns of Benson about Bloody Thursday. And then after the completion of the song, Benson approached members of his group, the Four Tops, and discussed recording the song with them. But listen to this. They told him they were not interested in recording it because it was a protest song. And he tried to defend the song by telling the other members of the group that it wasn't a protest song, but rather one that was about love and understanding, and that he wasn't trying to protest, but just wanted to know what's going on. And after the Four Tops refused recording the song, Benson gave it to singer Marvin Gaye, who went to modify the song in the following two ways. He added some new lyrics, and then he wrote an entirely new melody. Since the song was untitled at that time, when it was given to Gaye, he also gave it the title, What's Going On? And while Gaye was working on the song, he was inspired by the numerous social problems that were then going on in the United States. And one such social ill was the Watts riots of 1965, which took place in Los Angeles and left as many as 34 people dead, over 1,000 others injured. In addition to that, Gaye was inspired to write the lyrics of the song by conversations he had with his brother Frankie Gaye regarding Frankie's tenure in the Vietnam War, as well as the tragic death of his cousin, also in the Vietnam War. And according to Gaye, he just couldn't go on singing love songs when the world was exploding around him. The opening lyrics, Mother, mother, there's too many of you crying. Brother, 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 there's far too many of you dying. You know we've got to find a way to bring some lovin' here today. And now that iconic song, as recorded and sung by Marvin Gaye, What's Going On?
Brother, brother, there's far too many of you dying. You know we've got to find a way to bring some loving here today. Yeah. Father, father, we don't need to escalate. You see, war is not the answer, for only love can conquer hate. You know we've got to find a way to bring some loving here today. Picket lines and picket signs, don't punish me with brutality. Talk to me,
so you can see. Judge us simply cause our hair is long. Oh, you know that we've got to find a way. Bring some understanding here today. Oh, oh, oh. Picket line and picket signs. Don't punish me with brutality. Come on, talk to me. You can't see what's going on. Yeah, what's going on? Tell me what's going on. I'll tell you what's going on. Ooh.
Right, right on. Right on.
You know, I remember when that song first came out. I was a teenager, I think around 16 years old. I think it was 1970. And I remember not even understanding what that song was about. I just thought it was a cool, beautiful song by one of my favorite artists, singers, Marvin Gaye. I've been listening to him since I was, I don't know, 10. Loved his voice. And only in later years did I come to understand what that song was about and what inspired it. So in a moment, we're gonna close today. But before I do, I want to thank everyone for being with me today for Music Matters.
Thank you.
I thought it was important to address our situation and ways that are musically grounded, and music is the world's cry for every people. We know it very well as Jews, and here we are, and as Jews living in this country, we have a responsibility to respond and to act and to listen. And stay tuned to Wilshire Boulevard Temple's website, because we're going to be initiating a lot of different opportunities for us to act, to participate, to engage in very meaningful and I hope inspiring and hopeful ways in the months ahead. And we're going to close with what I think is the most hopeful of songs, and this is a video from one of the most beautiful, hopeful moments certainly I and I know others have had at Wilshire Boulevard Temple. It was from about 8 years ago when we reopened our historic sanctuary after it was closed for 2 years for refurbishment and remodeling. And we had that spectacular concert where we had every last seat occupied in the sanctuary, And we gather together over 150 voices from seven different traditions and choirs from all around the city. That was our first engagement with the fabulous choir from Faithful Bible Central Church and Dr. D and her group and the Los Angeles Children's Chorus, Wilshire Little Temple's Chorus, the Korean Chorus, all together in that sanctuary celebrating the reopening, not just for our own members, for the all of Los Angeles. And we closed that concert with Burt Bacharach himself coming out, sitting at the Steinway and starting his and Hal David's timeless song, What the World Needs Now. And here is that video. And one of the most beautiful things about it, two things for me. One, I had phone calls with Burt Bacharach like 10 times because he wanted to make sure what key was right and every little nuance, and I'm practicing with him on the phone. It was quite an experience for me. And he was insisting that I sing the whole song from the beginning, and I finally convinced him. I said, no, Burt, please, you have to sing at least the first couple of lines with your voice. It's so important. And finally, he agreed. So Burt starts the song. And the other thing that's so special about this video is that if you listen carefully, you can hear all 1,700 to 1,800 people in that sanctuary singing along, right? So enjoy. I'll see you again next Monday. Depending on what's happening, we may continue in a similar vein, or what I had planned, honestly, for last Monday, but, you know, and last minute scramble to put this show together, was a whole show about the greatest Jewish opera singers. So depending on where we are next week, we'll either hear that or we'll continue on with something perhaps a little bit more germane to the moment. But in any case, let's end today on a note and with a song of hope. What the world needs now is love, with Burt Bacharach and Don Gurney, that other white-haired singer. Here we go.
What the world needs now is love, sweet love. It's the only thing that there's just too little of. What the world needs now is love, sweet love.
No, not just for some, but for everyone. Lord, we don't need another mountain. There are mountains and hillsides enough to climb. There are oceans and rivers enough to cross, enough to last till the end of time. The world needs now love, sweet love. It's the only thing that there's just too little of. What the world needs now is love, sweet love. No, not just for some, for everyone. Lord, we don't need another meadow. There are cornfields and wheat fields enough to grow. There are sunbeams and moonbeams enough to shine. Oh, listen, Lord, if you want to know. There's just too little love. Well, the world needs.
Thanks, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you.
We'll see you next Monday.